Harbor. Stars winning this one.
Testing, testing, testing. Testing English, English, okay.
And French, French.
English, English.
Testing French. Okay, great.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's 10 o'clock. We'll begin the meeting of Ottawa City Council, the 27th of November. Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. On va commencer.
Good morning. We will be starting City Council meeting for November 27th, 2013.
Two, could you please stand for prayer and remain standing for the national anthem? Almighty God, let us work together to serve all our people. Dieu Tout-Puissant, aidez-nous à travailler ensemble afin de bien servir nos citoyens. Because of the weather, our guests from Councillor Holmes' office are not here. Maybe, Councillor, you can sing a solo for us.
Well, you wouldn't want that, Councillor. But I had 20 children coming in from school, grade 3 kids. And, of course, the buses aren't running. So we had 5 cars sitting there at the school this morning, but the school board says no. Verbal agreement is good enough. It has to be a written agreement. So we'll look forward to, in January or February, Mr. Chair, bringing them in because they've practiced for weeks. Thanks.
Great. Well, we look forward to that. So we'll have a recorded version of O Canada. Thank you very much, and we look forward to those students from Councillor Holmes' community in January. Also, because of the weather, our recipient for our Mayor's City Builder Award was not able to make it, so that individual will be honoured in January as well. Councillor Holmes, I believe you have an announcement with respect to World AIDS Day and the ribbons that are at our desk.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. You'll see there are red ribbons on all our desks this morning. It's AIDS Awareness Week. From November 25th to December 1st, it marks the HIV/AIDS Awareness Week across the world. For the past 2 years, public health and community agencies and concerned individuals have been working hard to achieve the goal of eliminating the spread of HIV infections. While HIV treatment has significantly reduced deaths from AIDS-related infections, new HIV infections are still occurring. In 2012, the rate of HIV infections in Ontario was 6.2 for every 100,000, which is similar to the infections across Ontario. Ottawa Public Health is working with partners to help reduce the spread of HIV in the community by promoting safer sex practices. Ottawa Public Health initiatives include the Sex It Smart program, providing HIV testing and supporting community groups that provide outreach to people at higher risk of HIV infection. I invite my council colleagues and Ottawa residents to wear a red ribbon to raise awareness of the goal of eliminating the spread of HIV infections. And for more information on HIV and AIDS, please visit ottawa.ca/health. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Councillor, and thank you for the work that the Public Health Unit is doing on that issue with respect to AIDS and HIV. Madam Deputy Clerk, roll call, please.
Conseiller Manette.
Present.
Councillor Blois.
Present.
Councillor Harder.
Here.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Present.
Councillor Alshantiri.
Present.
Councillor Cadre.
Present.
Councillor Taylor?
Here.
Councillor Chiarelli?
Here.
Councillor Eglie?
Here.
Councillor Deans?
Here.
Councillor Tierney?
Present.
Councillor Fleury?
Here.
Councillor Clark?
Ici.
Councillor Holmes?
Here.
Councillor Hobbs?
Here.
Councillor McCrae?
Here.
Councillor Chernyshenko?
Present.
Councillor Hume?
Here.
Councillor Blay?
Present.
Councillor Thompson?
Present.
Councillor Moffat?
Here.
Sia Darash?
Here.
Councillor Hubley?
Here.
Mayor Watson?
You see?
Le Kremit Ten, Monsieur le Maire.
Merci.
You have quorum. A confirmation of minutes.
13th of November 2013, the 13 novembre 2013, carried. Declarations of interest, including those originally arising from prior meetings. Declaration de conflit d'intérêt. Councillor Chiarelli.
Thank you, Your Worship. I declare a potential deemed indirect pecuniary interest on Council Agenda Item 66. Item 14, Community and Protective Services Committee Report 28, 2014, Draft Community and Protective Services Committee, Operating Capital Budget Committee and Social Services, Housing Services, Community Homelessness Prevention Initiative Emergency Shelter Solution on National Homelessness Initiative, page 68, as my daughter is employed part-time by Shepherds of Good Hope, an organization which could receive funding from these two budget lines.
Okay, thank you. Councillor McCrae, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I, Councillor Maria McCrae, declare a potential deemed pecuniary interest on Council Agenda 66, Item 18, Information Technology Subcommittee Report 5, 2014 Draft Operating Capital Budgets, Tax Supported Programs Information Technology Subcommittee. As a family member works for a subsidiary of a company which provides services and equipment for the Information Technology Services Branch.
Thank you. Councillor Moffat, please.
I, Councillor Scott Moffat, declare a potential deemed pecuniary interest on bylaw A on the agenda, a bylaw of the City of Ottawa to impose local improvement special charges for the Mantic Sanitary Sewer Hillside Gardens, as my brother, who is also the co-owner of the Marlborough Pub in North Gore, owns a property in this development. I added the Marlborough Pub.
I think that ad was a conflict of interest. thank you all, and remind members of council who have declared a conflict when we come to that item in the budget, if you can recuse yourself. Communications as received. I think Councillor Moffat, would you like to bring attention to the petition?
Yes, thank you. We spoke about this briefly 2 weeks ago. It's the petition was brought forward by residents of North Core. They brought forward a petition declaring that North Core be not a willing host. I worked with them on the motion that we put forward at council 2 weeks ago and passed unanimously. And I thank you them for their work at bringing this forward at this time.
Thank you. We have a technical problem with the system that alerts me that you'd like to speak. So you're going to have to wave to get my attention to get on the list. I apologize. Whoops. We may have it back and running. So Matt is working on that now. All right. It's now working. Les absences, regrets, none filed to date. Motion to introduce reports. Motion portant présentation de rapport. Conseil Blay et Hubley, s'il vous plaît.
That the report from the City Treasurer entitled 2014 Draft Operating and Capital Budgets, Tax Supported Programs. The report from the Committee of Adjustment entitled 2014 Draft Operating Estimates, Committee of Adjustment. The report from Crime Prevention Ottawa entitled 2014 Draft Operating Budget, Crime Prevention Ottawa. The report from the Ottawa Public Library Board entitled Ottawa Public Library Board Approval of 2014 Draft Budget. Ottawa Board of Health Report 11, Agricultural and Rural Affairs Committee Report 36A. Community and Protective Services Committee Report 28, Environment Committee Report 26, Finance and Economic Development Committee Report 38B, Information and Technology Subcommittee Report 5, Planning Committee Report 60A, Transit Commission Report 23, and Transportation Committee Report 32A, including amending page 63 of the Transportation Committee, operating capital budgets be received and considered, and that the rules of procedure be suspended to receive and consider the report from the Ottawa Police Services Board entitled Ottawa Police Service 2014 Draft Operating Capital Budgets, as it contains the Ottawa Police Service 2014 operating capital budget and must be considered at today's meeting, and that the rules of procedure be suspended to receive and consider Planning Committee Report 61 because of the urgency of the item contained in the report, specific reasons set out below, and that the petition for the residents of North Gore area of the City of Ottawa listed under communications be received.
Carried. So we'll go through the consent and bulk agenda, page 28, Planning Committee, report number 61, one item, regulatory framework and current practices, noise guidelines. Carried. Does anyone wish to remove anything from the bulk consent agenda? On the bulk consent agenda as presented, adopté, and page page 31, disposition of items approved by committees under delegated authority suite à donner des articles ratifiés par les comités en vertu de pouvoir délégué. Carried. Okay, we're now at the 2014 draft operating and capital budgets, and our deputy city clerk, as always, has produced a very helpful roadmap that we will follow. So Councillor DeRush and El Shantiri have a motion, but before we do that, we're going to resolve into Committee of the Whole. Councillor Blais, please.
Que le conseil municipal décide de siéger en tant que comité.
City Council sits as a plenary committee under item 48 of the procedure bylaw.
By Councillor El Shantiri.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. That City Council, as Committee of the Whole, receive and consider the draft 2014 operating and capital budgets as recommended by the Committee of Adjustment, Crime Prevention Ottawa, the Ottawa Board of Health, the Ottawa Police Services Board, the Ottawa Public Library Board, and by the Standing Committees, Transit Commission, and Subcommittees of Council. And the 2014 operating and capital budgets update rate supported programs as recommended by the Environment Committee, as listed in the Council agenda and incorporating all amended pages, and that further Council, sitting as a Committee of the Whole, receive and consider the following motion.
Okay, and so we're going to go one by one, and if anyone would like to ask questions or move motions, this is the time, but my understanding is that any motions have already been submitted to the Deputy City Clerk. So item number one is approve the 2014 draft operating budget for the Committee of Adjustment. Councillor Moffat has a question. So we'll ask the representatives from the Committee of Adjustment to come forward. And we have Heather McLean and Chair Phil Brown. Welcome, Ms. Councillor Moffat, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I just had a couple questions. I noticed, first of all, I just noticed that the fees, you have a large fee increase for this year. I know a lot of my constituents go to the Committee of Adjustment for a variety of reasons, and I just noticed that there's 12%, 22%, 33% increase in some of the fees. I'm just curious if you can explain why.
We've been undertaking a review of our staffing requirements over the course of the last couple of years. It initiated with a review of our fees 3 years ago, which resulted in some readjustment of our fees as a result of increasing need for us to be able to justify our fees to the Ontario Municipal Board if challenged. And as a result of that initial study on our fees, what was identified was a shortfall on our staffing. And our shortfall for staffing amounted to two positions, which are now reflected in our current budget for 2014. And there were really three elements that have been driving this issue. The first is that there's an increasing complexity of the applications, and this is continuing going forward. For example, the new infill zoning bylaw regulations that are being adopted by Council have resulted in more complexity in our zoning, which means more work for our staff in processing those applications and in dealing with the decisions coming out of them. We've also been required, and this has been relatively new in the last decade, the OMB and the courts have indicated that where there are contentious issues that we're dealing with, we need to be much more fulsome in our reports and our rationale and our explanations for why a decision was made by the committee. And so for what once upon a time would have been a fairly straightforward approved, not approved, we now have to have staff writing out much more complex decisions in conjunction with the committees themselves, which again is a drain on staff time. Lastly, there has been some downloading of responsibilities in the finance and HR areas, which most departments have been able to absorb quite easily within their own structures because they had the backup staff to do so. The Committee of Adjustment, being a relatively small organization overall with a number of staff, simply found that our staffing and our management in particular were being overwhelmed. The final piece that's not so much workload related but rather a long-term planning issue is one shortfall that was identified both by our during our fees study and also by the organizational review that we conducted was that our succession planning is going to be problematic in that we didn't really have the ability to be grooming a couple of people for potentially coming up into the secretary treasurer position, nor do we have adequate backup in the event of sickness or even in the event of vacations. So we wanted to address our ability to be a sustaining organization in terms of our ongoing HR requirements, and this has necessitated at some point having a bit of a budget hit, and that really is what we built into the little less than 13% budget increase for next year. This is going to be a one-time only increase, and we'll be able to be back to tracking inflation in future budgets. We're pretty confident in that.
I think that's a very thorough answer, so I don't know if Councillor Moffat had anything else.
I just want to follow up with one thing. So with the increase in your rates, obviously that just offsets the increase in FTEs, but you also show a decrease of almost $200,000 in revenues for 2014. So it seems, if I'm reading that right, on your user fees and revenues, you're projecting a $200,000 decrease in revenues.
I didn't think we are. No, our revenues are increasing. We are cost recovery, and we intend to remain cost recovery, and our revenues should be in line with the total budget. We shouldn't be looking for any kind of for the tax base to be supporting any of our costs.
All right. I can talk about it after. It looks as though it reads that way. So thanks.
Okay.
I think it might be the, if it's a bracketed item at 200,000, it might be a $200,000 increase. But if you can take that offline, Councillor, that would be great. Okay. Any other questions for Committee of Adjustment? Est-ce qu'il y a des autres questions? Carried. Thank you very much. Item number two is the draft operating budget for Crime Prevention Ottawa. Are there any questions? Est-ce qu'il y a des questions? Carried. Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Cadre and colleagues. Item number three is the Ottawa Police Service draft operating and capital budget. We have Chief Bordelot, the Deputy Chiefs, and the Director General with us, as well as the Chair of the Board. Thorough presentation. Many present. Councillor Harder, I believe you wanted the presentation one more time.
Six wasn't enough with no change.
All right. So on the board's recommended budget, Councillor carried, and thank you Chief Bordelot, Deputy Chief Skinner, Deputy Chief Keeley, and Director General Fraser, and certainly our Police Service Board Executive Director Wendy for your work. Item number four is approve the 2014 Ottawa Public Library Board draft operating and capital budget. Danielle McDonald is here and Chair Harder. Are there any questions? Est-ce qu'il y a des questions pour la bibliothèque? Carried. Thank you very much. Item number five is the 2014 Board of Health draft operating budget as recommended by the City's of Ottawa's Board of Health. Dr. Levy is with us and Chair Holmes. On the budget, carried, adopté. Thank you. I'd like to thank all of our agencies and partners for coming in under 2% in their draft budget requests. We very much appreciate their cooperation. Item number six is approve the 2014 draft operating and capital estimates as recommended by the Standing Committees, Transit Commission, and Subcommittees of Council as follows. The Treasurer, are there any changes of a substantive nature, Madam Treasurer, prior to us going department by department?
No, there aren't, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you. So the first one is item number 6A, the Agriculture and Rural Affairs Committee portion of the 2014 operating capital budget, including amended page 13. For Councillor Thompson's committee, carried. Thank you. The Community and Protective Services Committee portion of the 2014 draft and operating and capital budget is amended by the following. Councillor Shirelli is declaring a conflict of interest, and he'll remove himself from this discussion. So we have item number B, which includes approve the transfer of $43,000 from the Ward 8 cash in lieu of parkland account to be utilized for pathway and minor park improvements, capital account 904934, and that $43,500 be allocated from the citywide reserves presently allocated for capital account 904934 to the construction of a pathway within the West Cliff Hydro Corridor. Councillor McRae on CPS's budget.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, through you to Mr. Kirkpatrick. Mr. Kirkpatrick, at the Fedco budget deliberation, there was discussion about funds in economic development and how they may be adjusted for the SEAT team. And I'm wondering, given that the SEAT budget would fall under CPSC, if you have any comments about any adjustments that might be made to the SEAT team.
Mayor, the Councilor McRae's question, I think, relates to the discussion at Fedco with regards. It came about when the committee was considering the increase in funding to events audit. Thank you for that. It came about when the committee was considering the increase to funding to Events Ottawa, and the concern was the ability of Events Central and the SEAT team at the city side to be able to respond to an increased demand for service from more success in attracting different events to Ottawa. So as I indicated at Fedco committee meeting, I've met Mr. Bashir and I have met with Mr. Kanalakis and Mr. Chenier. We've talked about that. We're going to bring two approaches to that. The first one is that we're going to make sure that Events Ottawa and Events Central work hand in hand in terms of identifying strategically which events to target in terms of their timing and the audiences that they will attract and the amount of support that they'll require from the city, so that we're able to have a more balanced approach to the events we target and hopefully retain and keep here in the future and our ability to support them. In addition to that, recognizing that it may be there may be capacity required in on the SEAT team and Events Central, we will look at transferring funding. As you know, economic development has some increased funding this year. To the extent that that's required, we'll transfer that. We'll make sure that SEAT has the funding and the capacity it requires this year to handle that program.
Okay, through the Mayor, thank you, Mr. Kanalakis, or Mr. Kirkpatrick. Obviously, thanks to Mr. Kanalakis as well. And you were looking at in the order of approximately $50,000. Is that accurate?
At this point in time, we're trying to estimate what might be required, and it would be in that
ballpark,
in that order. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to say again what a great job that team does. In terms of this whole committee, there's a lot of great services that are offered. But in terms of SEAT, when you look at the fact that we're almost 1,000 events a year, it's nice to see that they've integrated so well with the city. And again, they're almost victims of their success, as is the other team, in terms of attracting events. So it's great to see this term of council that we start focusing on more economic development, whereas tourism and events are becoming more of the focus. And we're trying to build and move towards 2017. So thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Kirkpatrick.
Great. Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Shirelli. Okay. Councillor Holmes.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to talk about the community funding envelope. At the committee, we had the day programs come and talk to us with the Anglican Diocese, which was representing all our day programs. And I have three in my ward, drop-in centers and support centers. And they're talking about their the problem with only having a 1.5% increase this year when their costs are going up at a greater rate, and therefore they will have to be reducing the services they're providing. And in particular, the food service that they're providing, that they are not capable of anywhere near the Canada's food rules as they give out food. You know, there's a lack of ability for fresh fruit and vegetables, so it's mainly starch. They talk about giving out white crackers. Well, you might as well eat wallpaper as eat white crackers. So we have a long way to go to get nutrition. Into people's diets. So we're treating the most poverty-stricken of our residents with a diet that is not healthy. There's no way to stay healthy on the kind of diet that they are forced to eat, and we have a responsibility, as these are our residents, these are people living in our shelters and nearby rooming houses. We have a responsibility to provide a better quality of food, food that is actually nutritious. So we will be talking, I will certainly be talking with other councillors and the day programs and the diocese, the churches that provide the space and so on, looking to see how we can do some more strategic thinking on this matter and try to come back for the 2015 budget with a plan that will provide a better nutritious food basket for this, for the groups that we support. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Taylor, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor, and just want to touch on Councillor Holmes' comments. Mr. Kanellakis, I think, as you recall, we had an opportunity to meet the other day with Councillor Holmes, and of course wearing her hat as the chair of the Board of Health. Discussed that kind of approach coming into the next coming 2 years, about looking at bringing the what's emerged really within the health sector as being an important tenet of public health, which is healthy nutrition, bringing that into some kind of joint initiative between health and social services with respect to providing healthy food. But I just want to touch or maybe get your thoughts as well. Obviously, the councillor raised this within the context of the day programs that currently exist, but they are not operating in isolation in terms of the services out there that we fund that provide food for our residents. There are many other agencies as well. So perhaps either you or Mr. Burry could give us your thoughts on the broadness of the approach that would be required in order to address healthy eating across the different agencies which are funded.
Mr. Mayor, the discussion, really, the choice we have is to, you know, feel good and deal with some individual agencies or look at a broader plan like we did for housing and homelessness and try to affect an entire sector where food security and nutrition is becoming a larger issue in our community. We've heard from the food bank. We've heard from many agencies who are supporting our vulnerable and trying to get them nutritious food and ensure that there is food security, including trying to get retail stores in neighborhoods through the other work that's been done by many of our community groups and our community development program. And so the discussion really is about bringing the stakeholders together with the various departments that are involved in this initiative and come up with a plan that really tackles it from a much more innovative way with respect to how do we get not only funding, but how do we get these organizations to look at what they're doing from the perspective of in some cases, as Councillor Taylor and Chair Taylor raised, the issue of freezers and being able to store protein and to get away from just storing the carbohydrates and canned beans and all the rest of it. And how do we invest maybe in, from a capital perspective versus operating, to give them the supports and the tools they need to be able to better serve their clients with better food. So I think the approach we used and that the mayor and the chair of CPS led with respect to housing is an approach we can use with respect to this sector. And I look forward to bringing together the departments and working with Dr. Levy to bring together a plan that we can submit as part of our next, both committees, and as part of our next budget proposal in 2015 to make an impact in that sector.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. On Councillor Shirelli, I think you should remove yourself. Well, I think we're going to... Okay, so we'll vote on the emergency shelter section now. Carried? Okay, thank you. On item number B, carried. Item number C is the Environment Committee tax-supported portion of the 2014 draft operating and capital budget. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions sur ce sujet? Are there any questions or
any questions on this?
Carried. Item number D, Information Technology Subcommittee portion of the 2014 operating budget. Councilor McCrae has a conflict. Are there any questions or comments or motions? Carried. Adopté. Thank you. Thank you, Councilor Tierney. Thank you, Councilor McCrae. Planning Committee portion of the 2014 operating and draft capital budget, item E. No, this is later on, Councillor. Any questions on planning? Carried. Item F, Transit Commission portion of the 2014 draft and operating budget. Are there questions for transit? Carried. Item number G, the Transportation Committee portion of the 2014 draft operating and capital budget, including amended project 906893O-OTM REX CUR on page 6364 as amended by the following, and it's printed before us. Councillor Hume has a motion, a project that was omitted with the funding source. Councillor Hume,
for Linda Lane. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is a long-standing project that's actually was in the 2003 budget, but it was delayed at that time to provide a homeowner grant, if you recall when we did that. In 2009, it was revised, and it was supposed to appear in last year's capital budget, and it didn't. And I was assured that it was going to appear in this year's capital budget, and when it didn't, I queried staff, and they said, oh, we've omitted it, we forgot it, but you'll have to put it in at council, so I'm doing so.
Yeah, so this was, and you've talked with staff for the funding source, so it balances it out.
It is, absolutely. Mr. Mayor, it was original. This is the way it was originally funded in 2003 when we delayed it. It's a development charge funded project on Linda Lane. If you've been to Linda Lane, you'll know what it is. I don't know how much more you want me to go into.
I think we have a copy.
Why it was omitted, why we deferred it in 2003 to provide the homeowner grant, or delayed it in 2003 to provide the homeowner grant. It was rescoped in 2009 to reduce its scope in an effort to be much more affordable. And it was supposed to be in last year's budget, but it was, again, supposed to be in this year's budget. And as you can see from a memo issued by Ms. Sheppers, said, sorry, we omitted it. We should have put it in. Here it is.
Yeah, I think people have seen the motion. The speaker list on this one.
Oh, God.
Okay, Councillor Blois on this motion.
I could speak on this, Mr. Mayor, but it actually pushed my name before this motion was introduced, so I'm going to go back on,
okay,
and I'll probably speak to this afterwards. But
okay. Does anyone wish to speak to the Hume-Hobbs motion? Question, Councillor Deans.
I actually have a few questions about this because I have the list of cuts signed by Mr. Kanellakis back in 2003, and this project was cut by Council in 2003. Don't see that it was ever placed back in a budget. So just finding it a little hard to understand how we get a memo from the deputy city manager saying it was unintentionally omitted from the budget when it was cut in 2003 and never put back in a budget. Sounds like cue jumping to me.
Okay, deputy city manager.
Mr. Mayor, I think my memo is self-explanatory, and I apologize for being in front of you like this today because it was an oversight. Yes, it was in a previous budget. It was clearly identified as a priority of the council of the day. It was removed, and we did some work on it. It was intended to have been in this budget, and it was clearly an oversight that it is not in front of you today.
Was it in the TMP?
Mr. Mayor, it was a project that was already a priority. It is a citywide priority in terms of the hospital facility that's there. And as a result, it is before you today, and it was clearly oversight.
So it was not in the TMP, and it was cut from the budget in 2003 and never placed back. Is that correct?
Mr. Mayor, this type of project, it's urbanizing a project, and we have had difficulty in advancing these priorities in the past because they certainly are well needed projects. So council, it's before you today. It was identified in 2009 as a priority, and it needs to be added to the budget in my mind.
Okay, so it was not identified in the TMP, and it was not in a budget, and then we get a memo from you, Ms. Shepherd, saying that it was unintentionally omitted from this budget when it hasn't risen through the queue like everyone else's projects. That's what I'm asking. Like, it didn't show up as a priority in the transportation master plan. I just don't know where it came from. And, you know, with all due respect to my colleague, this is not about beating up on Alta Vista. This is about some fairness in the process. And this council decided to cut this project in 2003. It was never identified in our documents from that time forward as a priority. So it's a little hard to understand how it gets walked onto the floor of the budget at the last minute. That's all I'm saying. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Blois.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My question deals more with the funding source here, and certainly I'm mindful of the situation on Linda Lane, the parking issues and whatever else, and if there was an error in terms of omission, except I don't quite see it that way right now after the answers I just heard. But on the funding source, can you tell me how the development charges that are being identified here were targeted or earmarked for this project? Because when I ask questions about in the growth areas, I'm always told that we haven't collected, even though it's all growth related, it's all development charges are being paid, that there isn't enough money to put in to complete the streets and do the sidewalks and do the parks, et cetera. And yet suddenly we're earmarking here, and I don't think there's much there's much being collected in terms of development charges here, are there?
Mr. Mayor, this is being funded from development charges that are collected on a citywide basis.
Right.
It's not an area-specific charge. And the roadway modifications program, mm-hmm. which is collected, that's where this is being funded from, and that's an 80-20 DC citywide split.
Right. But when were these funds actually targeted here? Because I can understand that maybe the project was overlooked, but I've never seen the connection to the funding source before. So when did this come about?
When this project was originally established, mm-hmm. and I know it was cut in 03, but I don't know the year it was actually originally established. It was DC funded at that time. So this has been a long-standing project. It always was meant to reflect the growth that is happening as a result of that hospital and the services it's providing. So that's the link to the growth. And the roadway modifications program doesn't actually have specific projects identified within it. It's just a program of works that we identify projects as each budget comes along.
I know, but somewhere along the way, there's a leap here from a council decision in 2003 to suddenly appearing. And I guess that goes back to you, Ms. Shepherds. When did this leap happen? I know you're telling us this was erroneously left off, but when did we go from that council decision in 2003 that said this wouldn't happen to when, you know, I just want to make that connection here. I think there's a valid point's been raised.
So, Mr. Mayor, this 2003, it was identified as a priority. It has not fallen off the priority. It was taken off for other reasons, and it clearly fits the criteria to be funded from the DCs in terms of roadway modifications that are needed to advance the safety
particularly on this section of road, and people, I'm sure, are very familiar with it. So in terms of lighting and sidewalks, this is a high priority. And so staff had previously, had always supported it, and it came back. We tried to reduce the costs, as was indicated, and this is the price point for it, and I'm It was omitted in terms of the priorities.
Okay.
And as
but
you know,
shouldn't there have been a council decision? There was a council decision in 2003. Shouldn't there have been a council decision in the meantime that brought it back up and said, here's a priority that needs to be dealt with and funded, not to bring it forward like at the last second as we're concluding the budget? There have been lots of opportunities here to bring this forward. I do think there is a need there. There's no doubt that parking is an issue. There's that overflow from the hospital. But I think it's the way the whole process is being slipped in here. So thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Harder.
Just summing
this
up.
This is on not just this motion, but anything in
sure.
CPS. So.
Now he's back. That's okay.
Transportation.
I'm just asking a couple of questions from a couple of people here as well as myself. This is not in a growth area. So for those of us that represent growth areas and count on development charges and are told when we don't have enough saved of development charges that we're going to have to wait until we do, I'm just wondering, well, first of all, you can confirm if you want that it isn't a growth area, but I wanted to ask you, why would we not be putting this in the queue for the complete street program? Because it is in an older neighborhood, and if you look at Main Street and the amount of money we're putting there, or Preston or Bronson, why would it not go in turn with that? Because amongst us on this side that have growth, actual growth, we actually have a lot of priorities. And and the deal with our budget, as we know, because we approved it, is that if you can't find the money to take out of the pot that you already probably is in your ward, then you don't get to do it. So I think this is one of the reasons why we're having a problem with this. Why could it not be part of the complete street lineup queue for that money?
Well, Councillor, if I could perhaps add some clarity, this was an error on the part of staff. My office didn't catch it, so I'll take responsibility as well. It was supposed to be in the budget.
But it's a heck of a big error because, as Councillor Dean said, Mr. Mayor, a council actually voted on it many years
ago.
Yes,
well, that was a previous council, and we're a new council,
right,
and we're being asked.
This council hasn't been asked prior to today through all this program, development.
Well, Councillor, there are a lot of things that aren't in the TMP. Everything is not in the TMP, so let's set the record straight on that.
I guess
Councillor, do you have any other questions?
Yes. Why is this coming forward at this last minute without having the council approval prior to this? I mean, if you're going to answer that because it was accidentally left off, then that's your answer. Is that your answer? But we should have had a report.
Mr. Mayor, I apologize to council. This is not the way this should have been done. It was an oversight, and the department did not pick it up, and that is why it is in front of you right now.
But since 2003. So my last question is, are we still collecting development charges in this area for the Alta Vista corridor? Do we still have a dedicated fund for the Alta Vista corridor?
The Alta Vista corridor is part of the citywide road component, so we collect for that all over the city. So there's no account for the Alta Vista corridor per se. There is an account for development charges for road purposes. And it goes into there. So, and it's up to council to decide what they want to spend those development charges on.
Because I was told that there was an account for Alta Vista Corridor. So I was going to suggest that maybe that's some place that you want to take money out of. Okay. Well, that's fine. It's not fine because I don't think we're playing by the same set of rules that we all agreed to. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Shirelli on the transportation budget.
Okay, well, first of all, Your Worship, do we really have a rule that we only have 5 minutes for each budget? I thought it was five minutes.
No, we're in committee of the whole. You can put yourself back on the agenda,
motion,
so
right?
Don't worry about it.
Good.
There's lots of time.
I won't take 5 minutes. I'll have, I'm not sure I'm going to agree with either side on this. First of all, I agree that, you know, when we sit here and we look at these issues, there should be nothing wrong with bringing something on the agenda at the last minute, in quotes, because the reason we are sitting here is to consider those very things. So if our only role was to rubber stamp what arrived at our table today, yes, there'd be something wrong with us, but that isn't our role. Our role is to consider anything that's proposed here under the rules today. So I have no problem with Councillor Hume walking this on the agenda. The problem I do have with it is the notion that this is somehow cloaked in the trappings of a normal progression of a project coming to council. I don't see that. I do remember the vote against this back in 2003, I guess. But so I think we should be looking just at the merits of this and whether it should happen. I do think there has been an expression by council that we did not want this. Sure, it was a 2003 council, but that was the last time the council spoke on it. So I think we should be framing it that way. I am kind of bothered by this notion that's going around the table today that there's something wrong with raising new things at the table. Why are we here? Okay, so, and, or as Councillor Blow says, they're raising old things, but still, we should be considering it. The question is, what new facts have emerged to cause us to reach a different position than we reached in 2003? And did they emerge just last night? Because we did approve the Transportation Master Plan yesterday, and was this only discovered between yesterday and today, or was it discovered earlier? Because in supplying us with information, we would like to see it as early as we could. So I guess that's basically my only question. When did you discover this?
Mr. Mayor, it came up in the last week, and my memo went out on it when it was prepared and ready to go.
All right. Well, I don't take offense to it being raised here. I think that's why we're here. I'm still going to vote against it because I believe I did in 2003, and I believe most of those factors still exist.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Angli.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think I'm sitting too close to Councillor Shirelli because he raised many of the issues that I did. But the question he asked, which I also wanted to ask, which wasn't really answered, and I think is more relevant for those of us who weren't around in 2003, is it came forward in 2003, it was voted down in 2003. I'm sure there was a rationale put forward in 2003 as to why it should go forward. And as Councillor Shirelli asked, I think what I'd like to hear is what's changed? What is different from the ask in 2003 and the ask today that has it in front of us again and would require or solicit a different position from council?
Mr. Mayor, the hospital complex is a major city facility in the city, and it serves a citywide need, and it has been growing, and there are plans to grow it even further. Linda Lane is an important connector to that, and it is used by a lot of residents in this community who wish to visit the site, and they are parking there, and it has been deemed, and I'm sure the same, similar to 2003 in terms of the lack of lighting and the lack of sidewalks, creating a safety concern. Those are the types of things that, from a perspective of council, you know, your priority in terms of addressing safety, this is a big one, and it really is a citywide facility that it connects to. And there, you know, we look citywide when we're looking at those roadway modifications and prioritize them, and safety is a big part of that.
To go to Councillor Dean's comments, in the normal course, had everything occurred as it should have, would this project not have been in front of us yesterday when we considered the TMP?
Mr. Mayor, it is not. I mean, you saw in the affordability that we have identified funds for intersection modifications and and modifications to the network. So as your city grows, there is growth roads that kind of stand alone, and they are the subject of your transportation master plan. However, that growth in traffic overall in the city creates issues across the city that your development charges are used to pay for. And we would have prioritized that. It would have been in your budget as just another one of several projects that would have been in terms of the roadway modifications. So it wouldn't be in the transportation master plan because it falls under a different category.
Okay, last question. Process aside, let's put all aside when this came up, when it's put in front of us, all those other things. Does staff believe this is necessary? If you had to rank it amongst other similar projects in the city, other issues, would staff still be standing in front of us today and saying this is a project that needs to happen?
Mr. Mayor, absolutely. We support it as a priority, and it is right up there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Anglai. Councillor Blois.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to move on to another item in the transportation budget, but if others want to speak about this, I would gladly put myself
down. No, go ahead. We'll take it in the order people are listed.
It's interesting, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to raise something here for the fourth time over the course of the last month, twice during the TMP plus the budget, transportation budget, and it's Brian Coburn, a street that we did an EA, a roadway that we did an EA on in the 90s. We did redesign of intersections over the course of the 90s. And I know my colleague said something about there's nothing wrong with raising new projects. Well, I'm resurrecting an old project that's been sitting there dormant. But the reason I'm resurrecting it, I've had staff now give me answers three times. So this is the fourth shot at this. I'm looking at last year's budget book, and it put in $2 million for detailed design with funding for construction to follow in 2014. Here we are, 2014. We've got the same thing, funding this year being put in for detailed design with funding request for construction 2015. This land goes right through the employment lands. Yesterday, this might have been appropriate to bring up yesterday when we discussed employment lands. These lands have been sitting there dormant because infrastructure is way more important to developing employment lands than all the little incentives we can do and all the chasing of potential employers. So once again, and yesterday the answer when I asked it was, we're acquiring new properties for this corridor. So I'm going to go back. We did an EA in the 90s. We've been acquiring properties all along the way. Last year's budget showed $2 million for design work. Why are we suddenly identifying this year, putting off construction because we're suddenly acquiring? I know we need to acquire properties, but that was all previously identified. We've built a pond in the way of this. We've done lots of other things in the area. So can I get a direct answer here why the construction money isn't in the budget this year? And while you're getting your message together, we talk about how we estimate costs. Well, the costs have ballooned in 1 year, and I know the treasurer explained how this happens, but the funny part is we gave costs as part of the TMP for projects where we haven't even done EAs, and we compared them to other projects where EAs were done in order to differentiate where the priority should be. So somewhere along the way, what's the difference between last year and this year that we're not following through with construction funds the way we originally forecast?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, the primary, there was a delay in the purchasing and acquiring the land in order to complete the design. So we're still acquiring property and the design for that section of roadway has been delayed until we've got the property in hand. But and we're hoping to get to that in 2014, so that's our current schedule.
But the property, last year when we put money in for design, et cetera, we were already acquiring property, so we knew what we needed to acquire. We're sitting here a year later, and we're putting in more money to acquire more property. Is that what you're telling me? And we're not going to put any money towards construction.
The design estimate is based on the current timeline for acquiring that property. It's had an impact on those design costs, so we've incorporated that into this year's budget and our projections for 2014.
Okay. So when we get the budget books, and I must admit, do we always go back and compare to previous year's budgets? We usually don't. We look at this year's, except this one obviously triggered something, and it's got the identical wording, basically, other than now we're identifying that we'll add some bike paths and pedestrian or sidewalks. The description that we're given, in this case, doesn't really fit what's happening. And I know, there's so many pages, you've got so many projects on the go, and that happens. Some of it can happen from cut and paste. But we follow with some confidence what the description is, what the amount, what the funds that are being shown, and there's a gap between what happened last year and this year, and that's what throws us off here. I mean, if we're going to have confidence in the budget process, we need that information. Basically, the key part is a detailed design with funding for construction to follow, and you just change the year.
The description is to represent what was happened in 2014. It sounds similar to what was in the 2013 budget. The work is still the same. The objective is still the same. The acquiring of the property is still something that we have to complete as part of the final design of the project. So often the descriptions do sound the same, even if from year to year the work hasn't changed. There's some impact on design costs and anticipated construction costs, and that's been updated to reflect that.
So the significant increase then in the cost of this project over the next couple of years, that's really pushed us back. When we put on the affordability criteria, the litmus test of affordability, this really pushes us back. So we talk about affordability. The other initiative we're talking about here, somehow affordability isn't an issue. And I know that's not your project, but by changing the price that much, and if I'm not mistaken, we've increased the cost by 50% over 1 year. And I know the Treasurer already told us, because we're trying to be more accurate. But somehow, if every project increases by 50% over 1 year because we're trying to be accurate, there is no affordability anymore. We might as well throw everything out and start from scratch. So how does that happen? How do we get pushed back like that?
Well, through you, Mr. Mayor, we want to bring forward the most accurate estimates of these projects. We think it's important for Council to have that. And items and details of those projects do change from year to year as we get more information and as we get deeper into the design. So we think that it's important that the costs, if they go up, that they're reflected accurately in the budget.
Thank you for that. Mr. Mayor, I've got a couple of seconds left, and what I might want to point out here is we've been pushing for some of these connections in here into the employment lands for quite a while, and actually, because we haven't succeeded, we've actually pushed employment development back, and ironically, I'm looking over at Councillor Hume, he's been the beneficiary of this, because when the federal government actually looked at putting something in there, they weren't able to go, they couldn't get timelines for it, so of course they go to where they can reasonably move forward, and they've, we lose out on those opportunities, and that's what it really comes down to when we don't do infrastructure in a timely fashion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Cawdrey on transportation budget.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And Ms. Shepherd, just a question on this Linda Lane project. Coming back to 2003, and I wasn't on council, but at the time the council decided to vote against it in the budget. The following year in 2008, there was a TMP done, and I know you said earlier that TMP process is different than a budget process in terms of roads. My question still remains, if the staff felt at the time that strong enough about this project to say it should be on the budget and it didn't get approved, why would the staff not take the initiative to put it on a TMP in 2008? Or is it in the TMP in 2008? Because I don't see it there.
Councillor, I'll start responding to that because there's been a misinformation in what you just stated there. That project was actually approved as a budget item. In 2003, that was the first year we saw the reassessment came back and there was a shift of taxes from commercial onto residential. The council of that day decided they could not, we had no tools to mitigate at that time. They didn't want that to happen. So we gave a grant to any homeowner who had more than, I believe it was a 6% increase in their taxes as a result of the change in assessment. In order to fund that grant, council directed staff to go back and find a way to generate, I think it was around $2.3 million to provide as a grant. What we did was we went through a list of all of the capital works that were in place at that time. Any ones that weren't started, we put forward to council and said, close these to allow us to take the money that you put on those projects and use it to give to taxpayers as a homeowner's grant. Linda Lane was one of those projects that hadn't been started, so it was put on the list, and it only generated, I think, a couple hundred thousand. But in order to find $2.3 million, we were basically searching for crumbs in the cupboard to allow council to provide that tax relief to homeowners. So it wasn't that it was rejected at budget time. It was a budgeted item. It was to proceed. But then the whole issue of tax reassessment reared its ugly head, and we had to do something in the day.
And Mr. Mayor, if I might, in terms of the TMP process, so you will note that the TMP, when we went through that, we talked about the envelopes and we talked about roadway modifications. And across the city, we have the ability on a year-to-year basis to put forward projects that are road modifications that are funded through development charges, because the growth in traffic overall in the city is contributing to the need to do these roadway modifications. Typically, they are triggered by two things. One is the volume increases, and the other is safety concerns. And they tend to be tied, that as the volume of traffic goes up, the safety conditions are exacerbated. So I think that answers your question about why it would not be specifically identified in a transportation master plan.
Thank you for that, Ms. Similek and Ms. Sheppers. The question, though, still that sort of sits with me is the fact that if staff felt, or that the council of the day felt, that this was an important project, then to me would be on staff's behalf to say, look, it's such an important project, we should include it in the TMP in terms of its success, in terms of being constructed. Because in this year's budget, or in this year's TMP, for example, we're taking roads out and stuff that were in the 2008 project, TMP, yet not included in the TMP of 2013. So having said that, you know, in terms of this project, what I'm, you know, I understand the importance of it. I understand that, you know, it's close to, as Councillor Hume mentioned, in terms of CHEO and stuff. The, you know, the other, we do have other roads like this, and I'll give you an example in terms of Civic Hospital. And Councillor Harder mentioned that Ruskin Avenue, for example, has parking meters on it. Will there be parking meters available on Linda Lane in order for us to generate some revenue from it if this project goes forward?
There is not today, but I'm certain that council will want us to look at that as an opportunity.
I mean, that would make sense because you do have them in one health institution in terms of a Civic Hospital. CHEO to me, or not only CHEO, but the hospitals in that area would, to me, would be benefit in terms of a parking revenue coming out of this, plus to help pay for the project also. Is that a possibility?
Mr. Mayor, we could certainly take that as direction to explore that as we finalize this design, and we'll work with our colleagues in Public Works.
Thank you very much, Ms. Sheppers. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thanks, Councillor. Councillor Hume.
I'm intrigued by the interest in this project, and I think that, first of all, we've gotten a lot away from what this project is. It's not a TMP project. It wasn't matter what TMP, it would have never appeared in the Transportation Master Plan, because this is a public safety project. And Marion, Ms. Simulak is quite right. In 2003, it was a budget item. Had to be delayed because we needed money to provide that taxpayer relief. Now, the project didn't die. Actually, staff continued to work on it. And I sent you the memorandum. You all have received it from Morris and Hirschfield, dated in 2009, January 5th, 2009, where it's the Linda Lane Planning Study Progress Report and Evaluation Results. So it didn't end in 2003. It came forward in 2009. And at that time, there was a meeting of city staff, Carol Holmes, John Buck, Phil Landry, and they agreed on a solution. They said, this is the solution to go forward in the Linda Lane project. And it was to reconstruct Linda Lane on its current alignment, add a west sidewalk and illumination, and keep parking on the west side, and leave the rural cross section as a cross saving on the other side of the road. So that's what it was. That's the project. So it was never a TMP project. And since that staff recommendation, everyone has agreed, it has been waiting for a budget allocation, waiting patiently to receive its allocation. It was, as to be fair, it has always been in the queue to be funded since this was recommendation was made in 2009. And you see it there. I can provide you with the email trails that identify that, if that's of interest to members of council. And you know, Mr. Mayor, this is about putting lights on a street that has no lights and has parking virtually 24 hours a day. You saw pictures. People park their cars and walk to the hospital on the road. So if you go down there now, you'll see parking there. If you go down there at 9 o'clock at night, you'll see parking there. So this issue was a public safety issue. And we have been patient in waiting for it to come along and find its way into the appropriate budget. I and members of my staff fully believe that it would appear in this budget, and we were surprised when it didn't. And that is what provoked the discussion with Ms. Shepherds, and she freely admits, sorry, yes, this was a project. We have a staff recommendation. We have a staff review. We've spent consulting dollars on this to bring this forward. It should have found its way into the appropriate budget. So all the T's were crossed, all the I's were dotted, and this has come up in the normal course of advance. Save and except for a minor error, this would have been buried within the deep bowels of the transportation capital budget, and no one would have said anything. However, because of what happened yesterday and the discussions around the Alta Vista corridor, of course, and the reason this has to come in, this has now become the topic du jour. And it's really not, shouldn't be the topic du jour. It should be the topic about, is this a public safety issue? I think the answer is yes. Should we be trying to find a cost-effective solution to this problem that was identified and agreed to in 2009? The answer is yes. So, Mr. Mayor, I don't know how much more I have to say about the reason this project is here and debunk the idea that it's sort of been pulled out of the ether and slapped down onto the council table. I mean, this has been the subject, and I can give you more documents, and I have circulated the memorandum from Morris and Hirschfield in 2009 that was approved by our staff saying, yes, this is exactly what we want to do, and we're prepared to move forward. And it has been, I guess if there's a fault, it's for being so patient. I guess in 2009 I should have come forward and said, there's a staff recommendation, we should fund it now. But in essence, you know, respecting that there are some issues around the table, this we've been very patient for this to come forward. And indeed, we were told very clearly this will be in this coming budget. And Mr. Mayor, the only reason it's not before us is because of a clerical error. And I mean, I don't think that you should penalize, or we should penalize, the people who will be going to the hospital and parking on Linda Lane as a result of a clerical error. And I'll just add one more thing. I'm fully willing to talk about parking meters on Linda Lane. We've talked about it forever, but every time we talk about it, residents who park, not from my ward necessarily, but from everyone else's ward, are up in arms because now they have to pay whereas they had free parking before. But I'm fully willing to consider that and fully willing to move on that, Mr. Mayor. So I would just urge council, depoliticize this issue. It's a public safety issue, and move forward so we can get this project done and lights on that that street and a proper pedestrian connection.
And I, just to follow up on that, I can confirm that Councillor Hume did raise this issue with my office. We had every intention when I was working with the city manager to put it in the budget. It was one of these items that slipped between the cracks, plain and simple, and I take responsibility for that. And Ms. Shepherd's indicated that they were supportive of it. So just as many of you came to see me and to see my staff about particular projects, we tried our best to get them into the budget. This was one that we'd agreed to. We had staff support on it. Councillor Hume did his work by contacting my office, and we dropped the ball on it. So I take responsibility for that. So Councillor DeRush on this or anything else in the transportation budget, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, it's a question related to a different project in the ward, in the budget. For me, the motion before this is a very simple one, and I'm not sure why it's as complicated as is being suggestion. As was mentioned at the 2003 council, and I feel like we're taking a step back in time to previous councils with some of the dialogue on, I think, a very simple simple issue. I wanted to ask staff about Albion Road. I understand that finally there is funding for resurfacing of Albion Road between Leicester and Leitrim. Since the Transportation Committee, I've heard positive feedback from the Finley Creek, Riverside South community. Finley Creek community is very interested in whether cycling capacity can be added to that resurfacing project once it's underway.
Mr. Mayor, Albion Road is included in the 2014 resurfacing program. The overall program is just a little over $45 million. Albion itself is about $2.7 million. And as a result of Albion Road being identified as a spine route of the updated TMP, the project does include widening of the roads of the roadway to provide cycling. Of the $2.7 million budget, approximately $2.1 million is resurfacing the existing road with the additional $600,000 to accommodate the cycling lanes.
That's great. It's good to hear. It's about time. This is a critical network for the South sector and is so important to our transit system as well. The 99 uses that route on a daily basis. I wanted to ask you just on how we approach road servicing. Is that something where we enter into multi-year contracts for resurfacing? It's something we do every single year, and I guess I've never understood why we contract based on just on an annual basis. I would think that we might have the ability to do some innovative multi-year procurement so that we can try and stretch that dollar much further, because we know we have a very long list. And I think many of us would want us to do more. So are we looking at how we can stretch that dollar so that we can do more work and be, I think, innovative in our procurement?
Mr. Mayor, yes. As part of any renewal program, we're always looking at stretching the dollar everywhere from renewal strategies to procurement strategies. Right now in the resurfacing program, with the $45 million program, that will be multiple contracts within the particular year. We have been looking at multi-year contracts, but based on what we're seeing with the fluctuations in annual prices, the competitive nature out there, fluctuation in things like asphalt, cement, it doesn't seem to be appropriate that that we do a multi-year, because we seem to be getting extremely favorable prices. But of course, as anything, we're always continuing to look at alternative of options. And something we have on the radar is just that some of the pricing we've been receiving lately, we've been really pleased with, and we've been moving on that front. But certainly willing to continue to look, and perhaps even Councillor DeRush and our department can have an offline further discussion on that matter.
Yeah, thank you for those answers. I'm happy to have that conversation offline. Back to Albion, the intent would be to start that in the springtime, correct?
Mr. Mayor, it's in 2014. I haven't got the exact start date of that particular roadway as part of the overall program, but the intent is to undertake the work in 2014, and as following the approval of the budget process, information will be disseminated to all councillors on the timing of works in their wards.
Great. Happy to hear that. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor DeRoss. Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Mayor. Just a question on this motion on Linda Lane. It's the development charge bylaw lists all the roads that are going to be paid for from the development charges that are collected. Is this road in that list?
This is part of the roadway modifications program, which is just a program. It doesn't have individual locations listed. The intent is in the next bylaws that we're going to have more detail around those programs that are in there. It's not a road per se, like so for the new roads that are being identified.
So this one is, you're not working on the road. I can't really tell from what's on the motion, but it says sidewalks. I've heard lighting, but you're not rebuilding the road. Is that what we're getting at? I've got it open, but I haven't had time to read it yet. Just in general sense, is that what, you're not rebuilding the road then?
Councilor, let's staff answer.
Mr. Acting Mayor, the preliminary look at it is, it's not the intent to rebuild the roadway. We're looking at various options for the purposes of installing the sidewalk along the roadway. It is a rural type section. At this point, we made allowances for everything from storm sewers to partial road reconstruction. Those details will unfold as we move into the design phase, and we've made the appropriate allocation in the budget to ensure that we can complete the project, but are hopeful that it'll come in and lower than what we're currently estimating.
Because I know the safety concern is there, but I look at another safety concern. They've just been rebuilding the bridge over the 417 at Marsh Eagleson. They put a nice new sidewalk on it, and we have no sidewalk leading to it from either side, so people are walking on that road to get to the park and ride. If you want a safety issue, that's a huge one. And I thought it was be done as part of the project, but it doesn't seem to be, and I've just asked Steph and the city manager, and he said it should be probably the city doing it. I don't know if anything's happening on that, but I really think when we're looking at safety issues, we have to prioritize them somehow and try to get all the ones we need. So I can understand why this one's here and why he wants to get it done, whether it's the number one priority, and I really, really resent having it dumped on us with no further information before, without having it in any kind of plan. So we have in the budget book, we have nice little information that tells us about them and all the rest of it. So I think that's what's bothering all of us on that. So that's all I'm going to say about that part of it. I do have a motion I'm bringing forward later, but I'll wait till we finish this motion before I bring that forward. That's all right.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Thompson, do you want to speak? Councillor Clark, please, has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Curiouser and curiouser. I'm not sure whether it was the March Hare or the Mad Hatter. I seem to have come into some other world here. You know, the transportation budget was put together, and apparently they left something out. Well, that's too bad. It's the document's about 8 feet thick, and leaving something out doesn't surprise me. I just wonder how much else has been left out. But it worries me a little bit when I hear that it should be in the TMP. Well, we don't have everything in the TMP. The TMP is not a detailed budget document. Linda Lane, for example, the hospital visits, the hospital itself has been expanded a couple of times. The amount of visits coming in there has been expanded exponentially. If it was a problem back in the early 2000s, it's a bigger problem today. And whether or not it should compare to some new growth area out in the West End or some other feelings that were hurt because they didn't get certain things done, it seems to me to be that the chip shots are not particularly flattering to this council. I look at this and I say, well, it's funded, it's taken care of, it's supportable from that point of view. And if there are other projects that should have been supported and weren't in there, then the councillors in question should be asking why they aren't in there and why didn't they get them in there, as opposed to taking a run at this one. In any event, I will be supporting that motion, and I will be, as I did at transportation, supporting the transportation budget. Although I hope this meeting won't run as long as the transportation committee did.
Thank you, Councilor Clark. Councilor Manette.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. I just have a few questions on this issue. When does this rank? Where does it rank on the priority list? Like, does it affect anything that's on the priority list that's there already?
Sorry, Mr. Acting Mayor. No, it is not offsetting any priorities.
Okay. So anything that's that was prioritized before, it comes under that? Is that correct?
That's correct, Councillor.
Okay. I wasn't there in 2003. Why was it taken out of the budget at that time? Does anybody have answer?
Councillor, it was taken out because we were looking for money to provide a grant to homeowners who were seeing an increase in their taxation as a result of the reassessment that year. That was not a result of a budget decision by council. They were seeing their taxes increase basically because there was a shift from commercial taxes onto the residential sector.
I will be supporting this motion. I'm really surprised that there's so much concern about it coming at the table. I think this is a proper place to have that discussion. In fact, you know, having been on council, previous council, I remember the council meetings lasting a lot longer for many more discussions that were brought up at budget tables. If this would have affected projects that were prioritized before, then I would have had an issue on it. But since it does not affect those projects, I think the councillor has a right to bring anything forward, and I will be supporting it. Thank you, Deputy Mayor, or Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Tierney, please.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. First of all, I'm a little conflicted on this because my wife is messaging me, and she goes to the hospital all the time with her grandmother, and she's saying it needs lighting, it needs street walks. So I'm really conflicted on this, and I think there's agreement from most people that it is a priority area. I guess the problem comes down to the process, and I guess one of the questions that I have is I had a quick look at the pedestrian plan as well. Would that not highlight things that are of serious concern, especially something like Linda Lane, because I don't see it in there, and this isn't about transportation master plan. This is about pedestrian safety. So could somebody on staff tell me why it does not appear in there?
Mr. Mayor, it was identified as a priority, and as I said, it was intended to be in this budget. I wish it had been brought forward and we could have had it in front of you at Transportation Committee. We did not. Given that and our focus in terms of the TMP on missing links and so on, and yes, if it had been a missing link, this was driven more by safety, and in that case, not everything that would be driven by safety would necessarily come into the TMP, even on the pedestrian side. So it, you know, you need that flexibility when you've determined that there is a need for lighting or a need for sidewalks that's driven by safety. And that's why the program in the DCs has been, it doesn't specify, because those things you need to identify on a year-over-year basis. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, it doesn't. It doesn't, because I guess the big thing is, this is my, you know, we're entering our fourth year on council, and if it's such a grave concern, this is the first time I've heard it, and again, I'm concerned that, you know, this is a process-related issue more than anything. It does have to be fixed. If this was going through the correct channel, I would be supporting it completely, but I'm very concerned about the process. I'm wondering if somebody on staff can answer this. Is there an opportunity to refer this back to transportation for a wholesome discussion? Because we have raised the discussion about possible revenue opportunities. I personally wouldn't support that. People park there for free, and they should be able to enjoy that. But there is a lot of questions, and I don't think we've had the full bumper-to-bumper discussion on what can happen with Linda Lane. And if it is urgent, I'm sure if you brought it back there, we could find a way to make things happen. But I'm very concerned about this process.
Mr. Mayor, if I could just draw your attention to page 114 in the budget, and you will look through that, and I think you will identify that there's a number of projects there that you individually would not be familiar with. And I think it's important for you to understand, the list is not there, but if we went through and gave to you what we will be doing. Oh, sorry, it is below. So you will find that those are not necessarily projects that come up in our discussions at a council level, and they're not citywide discussions because they tend to be localized. And that is appropriate, and that's where you would have found this project. And it would have been there had we caught it in time for the budget, and it would have been one of a number of projects that were on the list. It's not, and so now we're talking about it as an individual project and having a, you know, quite a big discussion about it that wouldn't have happened had we done our job and had it on the list initially.
Great, and I really do appreciate that, and I do understand this for sure. I've just spoken with a colleague, and I think he has a motion that will probably sort a lot of this out in regards to reserving that element of money that's required to do the work, but will also have the ability to be able to make, you know, so we can have the discussion before actually applying that money. So I'll take myself off the list. I'll wait till that motion comes forward, and we'll see where we move on from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Hobbs.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. I just want to say there's two hospitals in Kitchissippi Ward, and Ruskin Avenue, which has been discussed today, will be undergoing a transformation in the next year or so to make that residential street safer. And, you know, those are very important things to a neighborhood when you have citywide traffic coming to your neighborhood. In 2003, you weren't debating whether or not this was a good project. You were looking at getting a parcel of money to do a tax rebate. So to say that you cut this project is kind of disingenuous for the reasons that it wasn't a required project. Now we're waiting 10 years to get something done that was identified as a priority for safety of all the citizens in Ottawa. It's all the citizens in Ottawa and beyond that use these hospitals, not just the neighbourhood. And as this was an oversight, just an error that this didn't appear in the budget, I'm just really surprised at the level of debate on whether or not we would consider that the citizens of Ottawa should be protected in this high-priority project. You know, the minute somebody is hurt here, we're all going to be wondering why we didn't do this 10 years ago. Now we have the opportunity to rectify this and put this back in the budget where it was supposed to be, and I would urge everybody to vote for this, and I certainly will be supporting it today. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor El-Shantiri, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I know a lot of questions been asked about the process, and some of us still probably not satisfied with the way this process taking place. But I'd like to draw your attention, colleague, is when we talk about the health and safety of our residents and how important that issue in the area is not being used by the Alta Vista resident. As a matter of fact, I think the resident from across the city and outside the city would use that road more often than anyone else. I sit on the board of director for Empire Hospital, and a lot of the residents in my area, which is 25% of them, use Empire Hospital, and they fight sometimes with the paramedic because they want to go to Empire, not to the Queensway or any other Ottawa hospital, for one simple reason, is the parking and how can you visit your loved one. So the biggest complaint Empire had this year, and it was because we had a parking, we raised it to $2. And unlimited, $2, you can park all day. Compare that to Ottawa, you need a loan on your house to visit the Ottawa hospital. And we heard about it this summer, time and time again, from all our residents. It is a cash grab, was called all the parking lots in the hospital, doesn't matter which hospital, within the city of Ottawa limit. So now we have something to help these people to ease their pain. And believe me, at first when this was, I wasn't going to support it. But then when we start thinking about the health and safety, what we heard from folks like Councillor Turner's wife say, you know, we need lighting there. The people leave at midnight or early in the morning in the dark. And that's what I wanted to bypass the process. Again, I'm not happy with this process and how we arrived. It doesn't matter whose mistake and whose fault it is. That's not the way to do things. But then don't compromise the health and safety on a process. We can always correct the process, but you cannot always correct the health and safety of the community. So I will urge you to vote for and make sure something like this in the process doesn't happen again. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Wilkinson, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Because you're taking general one, I do have another motion that I'd like to get onto the floor after this one is dealt with. First, just to Councillor Hume, I'd like to say I liked your idea of putting parking meters there. It's a fast, and I expect that you'll do that. But the motion I have is about the crossing guards. So, whereas no funding has been provided for new locations for adult crossing guards to commence in September 2014, whereas there are 22 locations already submitted for review to see if they meet the warrants, and whereas the General Manager of Public Works has informed me by email that budget adjustments can be made in the summer once the evaluations have been completed, therefore be resolved that the Public Works be requested to fund up to $24,000 within existing budgets for up to 4 locations for adult crossing guards, if warranted, through budget adjustments following evaluation so that crossing guards can be located at the most needy locations that meet the warrants in September 2014. Now, this has been prepared by staff and is supported by staff, just for your information.
Right. Councillor Shirelli.
Thank you, Your Worship. Thank you, Your Worship. I have a referral motion dealing with Linda Lane. It's be it resolved that Council reserve the space in the budget for the Linda Lane project, but hold funding in abeyance until the project has been referred to the project to Transportation Committee for examination, public consultation, and recommendation. I don't have a problem with the process of bringing the item forward. I think that's why we meet today. I agree with many of the merits presented, but for the project to be considered properly relative to other projects, I think there has to be a meeting where committee sits and looks, compares it to other needs, and assuming it would come out on top, which I guess it would, consider other issues around it, such as parking meters, such as all the other things that you would look at normally with this kind of project. I think the process isn't the problem. I think the problem is the council did reject this, and I think the proper thing to happen when council rejects something is that when the item's brought back, it's brought back with some notice and telling council, this is something you rejected, but we think you should consider it again for this reason, that reason, or something else. I think that's ultimately at the root of it. I think if we refer this, my discussions with Councillor Hume show he has a strong case, and I think if we put this in the hands of Councillor Eglai and his group, they should handle it with some degree of competence and be able to bring it forward at the next next transportation meeting. So it doesn't prejudice the project because it will leave the money in the budget, the money space in the budget. The only thing that could happen is, you know, if it turns out there is no merit, which doesn't appear to be the case.
So who is seconding your referral? Okay, I'm going to speak against referral, and I'd encourage members of council to be pragmatic on this issue. Linda Lane is an historical problem. It's never been fixed. We heard from Councillor Tierney's wife, and I'm sure we'll hear from others, that this is a problem. If you go down there, there are no sidewalks, there's no lighting, thousands of people are going to CHEO, the Ottawa Hospital, the Children's Treatment Center, DND Medical Center, the place is burgeoning and growing with an aging population. And it's just not a problem for Councillor Hume's ward. This is, let's put personalities aside, this is not an Alta Vista issue. This is a hospital that is serves every single ward. It's the regional cancer center. It's the emergency system for all non-traumatic patients in Ottawa and, quite frankly, the Ottawa Valley. And as a council, simply passing the money and then sending the issue back to Councillor Eglise's ward, quite frankly, makes no sense, because if you pass the budget, then the project should proceed. So I'd encourage you to vote against referral. That's why we're here at Committee of the Whole. I'm surprised this item is taking as long, because we've admitted, both myself and the Deputy City Manager, that it was inadvertently left off the list. I think at a $3 billion budget, to have one item fall between the cracks is not something that we should be spending a lot of time on. So I'd encourage you to vote against referral. Councillor Hume on referral.
No, Mr. Mayor, you've said it all.
On referral, Councillor Taylor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. And I'm going to be voting against referral on this, and I think the comments have been recycled many, many times around the table. But, I mean, this is not exactly a project that fell from the sky. The report from 2009 is half a decade old that indicates that there's clearly a problem here. Certainly within the context of our aging older adult population and the increasing numbers that facility sees, there's clearly a need for this. To my colleague, Councillor El-Shantiri, who indicated that if there's process issues, certainly we can look at those process issues as we move forward. But at the end of the day, the people who need to access Linda Lane and access that complex, if they need a sidewalk to do so safely, I think it, practically speaking, it's the right thing to do to give them one. So I'll be voting against referral.
Okay, Councillor Blay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to put both questions, please.
Okay, seconded by Councillor McRae. The question has been put on the deferral motion and the delay. I'm sorry, and Linda Lane, on both. Okay, so yeas and nays, Madam Deputy Clerk. Shall the question be put? Shall the question be put on both items? All right, okay, so yeas and nays.
Nays on calling the question, please.
Well, we have to do deferral first. So yeas.
On calling the question.
No, I think we just, my understanding was that people said carried on the question be put. Is that correct? Carried. Dissent by Councillor Shirelli. All right, so we have the first motion is Councillor Shirelli, seconded by Councillor Tierney, that the project be, I can't quite read your writing here, but basically the referral to the committee, correct? All right, so on referral to committee, yeas and nays.
Councillor Wilkinson.
No.
Councillor Hubley.
No.
Councillor Blois.
Yes.
Councillor Holmes.
No.
Councillor Cadre.
No.
Councillor Minette.
No.
Councillor Shirelli.
Yes.
Councillor Hobbs.
No.
Councillor Clark.
No.
Councillor Eglise.
No.
Councillor Desroches.
No.
Councillor Hume.
No.
Councillor El-Shantiri.
No.
Councillor Chernyshenko.
No.
Councillor Taylor?
No.
Councillor Moffat?
No.
Councillor Thompson?
No.
Councillor Tierney?
Yes.
Councillor Blay?
No.
Councillor McRae?
No.
Councillor Fleury?
No.
Councillor Harder?
Yes.
Councillor Deans?
Yes.
Mayor Watson?
No.
5 yeas, 19 nays.
Okay, and vote on the motion by Hume Hobbs, yeas and nays.
Councillor Wilkinson?
Yes.
Councillor Hubley?
Yes.
Councillor Blois?
Yes.
Councillor Holmes?
Yes.
Councillor Cadre?
Yes.
Councillor Minette?
Oui.
Councillor Shirelli?
No.
Councillor Hobbs?
Yes.
Councillor Clark?
Oui.
Councillor Eglise?
Yes.
Councillor Darroch?
Yes.
Councillor Hume?
Yes.
Councillor Alshantiri?
Yes.
Councillor Chernyshenko?
Yes.
Councillor Taylor?
Yes.
Councillor Moffat?
Yes.
Councillor Thompson?
Yes.
Councillor Tierney?
Yes.
Councillor Blay? Councillor Blay?
Yes.
Councillor McCrae?
Yes.
Councillor Fleury?
Wait.
Councillor Harder?
Yes.
Councillor Deans?
No.
Mayor Watson?
Yes.
22 yeas, 2 nays.
Okay, thank you. On Transportation Committee, other items, Councillor Wilkinson has a motion. Councillor Wilkinson, seconded by Councillor Blois.
I read it out already, Mr. Mayor, and it's approved by staff as a way of dealing with this if we do have places that need them next
week. Only if it's warranted on this motion, carried. Anything else on transportation, on the transportation budget as amended? Carried. Item number H is the Finance and Economic Development Committee portion of the 2014 operating and draft budget. Councillor Shirelli, please.
Thank you, Your Worship. My question is for the Treasurer. Relating to, and it relates to expenditures so far on authorized spending and how that can relate to what we do in the future. And it is basically how many of the, or what percentage of the parcels of land required for light rail phase one have been acquired? How much has been spent on that to, in that regard, and what percentage of the budget for that has been spent to this point?
Mr. Mayor, I don't have that information available today, but with the councillor's agreement, we would bring back that the response to that for the next FEDCO meeting.
Okay. All right. Can you confirm, though, that you don't require any additional budget authorization?
At this point in time, we don't. From what I understand, we're within the budget for the property acquisition at this point in time. So, but we'll provide a more detailed response to you if you would like for next FEDCO.
Yeah, we'll want that. But do you know at this time when the anticipated completion of the acquisitions will occur?
Mr. Mayor, I don't have the final date. I would expect at this point we will be completed in Q1 of 2014, and we would be able to report out after that. There may be a few holdouts, though, so in terms of some of the construction staging areas and so on that we need.
You are in discussion with all of the ones that you have not yet acquired, right?
That is correct.
Okay. All right, so if you could bring that to FEDCO, I will stand back on it.
All right, thank you, Councillor. Councillor Harder has a motion that we discussed yesterday during TMP and OP. Councillor Harder, seconded by Councillor Hume.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is with regard to the advancing the employment land study from 2015 to 2014. As you recall, yesterday there was a motion that talked about asking the industry to provide $250,000. This is the and which has been agreed to, but will be formalized. But what we need is to include our share, which is $250,000 for the study to come from citywide reserves. That's why this motion is necessary.
Carried. And we found a source to balance off. So carried.
Carried.
Thank you. Anything else on FEDCO? Est-ce qu'il y a des autres choses sur FEDCO? Adopté. 7, the readoption of the 2014 rate-supported operating and capital budgets as recommended by the Environment Committee, including the amendments to user fees, identified changes to the rate-supported operating and capital budgets, and the funding adjustments for the rate-supported portion of the integrated road, water, and sewer capital project. Carried. Item number 8, approve that the City Treasurer make the necessary adjustments to the 2014 draft operating budget and to make the necessary authority and debt financing adjustments to the 2014 operating budget and to make the necessary authority and debt financing adjustments to the 2014 draft capital budget to reflect the decisions of City Council. Carried. So we now have a motion to rise and report, unless there are any other points at Committee of the Whole. Councillor Blais, please.
Que le comité plénier se lève et présente.
That the Committee of the Whole rise and report to City Council.
This is the opportunity to speak to the budget. We're at Council now. Comments from anyone on? Councillor Clark, please.
Well, I'd like to congratulate staff on an effort that clearly took time and energy to craft something that would be accepted by the mayor. And I didn't want the mayor to be the only one speaking on the budget.
Okay, so motion to adopt budget reports. Councillor Blais first, I apologize, and then we'll have remarks, but we've heard Councillor Clark.
That the report from the City Treasurer entitled 2014 Draft Operating Capital Budgets Tax Supported Programs, the report from the Committee of Adjustment entitled 2014 Draft Operating Estimates Committee of Adjustment, the report from Crime Prevention Ottawa entitled 2014 Draft Operating Budget Crime Prevention Ottawa, the report from the Ottawa Police Services Board entitled Ottawa Police Service 2014 Draft Operating and Capital Budgets, the report from the Ottawa Public Library Board entitled Ottawa Public Library Approval of 2014 Draft Budget, Ottawa Board of Health Report 11, Agriculture and Rural Affairs Committee Report 36A, Community and Protective Services Committee Report 28, Item 1, 2014 Draft Operating Capital Budget, Community and Protective Services Committee, Environment Committee Report 26, Finance and Economic Development Committee Report 38B, Information Technology Subcommittee Report 5, Planning Committee Report 60A, Item 2, 2014 Draft Operating Capital Budget, Planning Committee, Transit Commission Report 23, and Transportation Committee Report 32A, including amended page 63 of the Transportation Committee Operating and Capital Budgets, be received and adopted as amendment. That City Treasurer make the necessary adjustments to the 2014 Draft Operating Budget and to make any necessary authority and debt financing adjustments to the Capital Budget to reflect the decisions of City Council. And that the city manager or his delegate be authorized to make application for any subsidies or grants on the city's behalf, and that any requirements for bylaws to implement the budget decisions be forwarded directly to council, and that any dissents and declarations of interest recorded during the Committee of the Whole session be deemed to be recorded in the council session.
Comments? Questions? Councillor McCrae?
Mr. Mayor, it's more a procedural question. In terms of the conflict of interest being deemed applicable to the session of council, that means we don't have to read it again because we read it once during Committee of the Whole. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. Just want to make sure.
So I'd like to offer a few comments of my own before we cast our votes on the 2014 budget. First of all, I'd like to thank members of council for once again providing me the opportunity to work with our city manager and treasurer in the creation of the draft budget, which was tabled on October 23rd. I'd also like to thank all of you individually for your input to this effort. Budget 2014, our fourth budget as a council, is also the last of this mandate. Le budget 2014 est notre quatrième en
2014 budget is our last as a council. It's the last in this mandate.
The Ottawa Public Police Service, the Ottawa Public Library, and Transit Services and the Transit Commission for meeting the targets we have set as a council. We've accomplished a great deal together over our first 3 years, and 2014 will be no different. We have restrained the tax rate to the lowest level it has been in 7 years at 1.9%. We're applying the same limit to average transit fare increases, and we will continue our $14 million annual investment in our housing and homelessness investment plan. Nous allons continuer d'investir.
We'll continue to invest the $14 million in our plan, investment plan for affordable housing and to deal with homelessness.
In cycling infrastructure in the city's history. and we will see the conclusion in 2014 of our own homemade infrastructure renewal plan, the $340 million Ottawa on the Move plan. Budget 2014 will freeze the waste collection charge at $82 per household and also see a continuation of the freeze on the Mayor's office and Councillor's office budgets. Budget 2014 also proposes for the third year in a row a reduction of 55 FTEs at the City of Ottawa. This budget is the second year of setting aside extra capital funds for renewal, as the long-range financial plan prescribes, some $15 million, with $10.4 million coming from the citywide portion of this budget. And our credit ratings remain high and unchanged. Moody's has provided us with its highest rating, AAA, and Standard & Poor's is AA+. The Treasurer has reported that Ottawa's net total debt per capita is second lowest among major cities including Toronto, Vancouver, Edmonton, Calgary, and Montreal, based on the most recent numbers available. Le Trésor a indiqué que la dette totale nette.
The Treasurer has pointed out that the net per capita debt of Ottawa is the second lowest of major cities, including Toronto, Edmonton, Vancouver, Calgary, Montreal.
2014's capital budget. The city is in good financial shape, and I believe that we have a good balance with the 2014 budget. We have injected more funds into areas of need, and we've held the line on others. On the environment front, we're spending more on forestry. We're investing in the arts and culture community. Nous investissons dans les arts et la culture.
Investing in arts and culture.
In a row on parks and recreation fees, and this is a step that benefits families across the city, especially those with lower household incomes. And we're putting extra funding into economic development in challenging economic times for the Ottawa workforce. We're continuing the Service Ottawa initiative in 2014, and this effort will return more than $4.7 million in net savings to our bottom line. Nous poursuivons l'initiative de Service Ottawa.
We continue the initiative of Service Ottawa in 2014. This will help us to save $4.7 million in net savings.
Libraries, public health, and all our agencies that depend upon the city. In addition, next week we'll open the spectacular new Richcraft Recreation Complex in Kanata, and next year we will be opening the new Barrhaven Minto Recreation Complex. Of course, there's much more that I can list and could go on, but you get the idea. Colleagues, as a council, our task is to effectively control costs while continuing to provide the services that our residents rightly demand and need. Police, fire, paramedics, transit, garbage removal and recycling, libraries, public health, parks and recreation, road maintenance, and so much more. I believe that Budget 2014 meets this challenge, and I'll be voting in favor. Je crois que le budget 2014 répond aux défis.
I think this budget 2014 meets a challenge. I vote in favor.
Who gave us their input. We didn't have a large turnout at our public budget meetings, but certainly we heard individually from individuals, whether it was through the shopping tour approach that we adopted, the email approach, online constituency meetings, and the public meetings and committee meetings. Again, my sincere thanks to members of council and our staff, who we should be very proud of, who once again have proven how fortunate we are to have them work with us all. Now, the roll call, please, Madam Deputy Clerk, on the budget as amended and presented. Yeas and nays, please. Merci.
Councillor Wilkinson?
Yes.
Councillor Hubley?
Yes.
Councillor Blois?
Oui.
Councillor Holmes?
Yes.
Councillor Cadre?
Yes.
Councillor Minette?
Oui.
Councillor Chiarelli?
Yes.
Councillor Hobbs?
Yes.
Councillor Clark?
Yes.
Councillor Eglai?
Yes.
Councillor Darroch?
Oui.
Councillor Hume?
Yes.
Councillor Alshantiri?
Yes.
Councillor Chernyshenko?
Yes.
Councillor Taylor?
Yes.
Councillor Moffat?
Yes.
Councillor Thompson?
Yes.
Councillor Tierney?
Yes.
Councillor Blais?
Oui.
Councillor McCrae?
Yes.
Councillor Fleury?
Oui.
Councillor Harder?
Yes.
Councillor Deans?
Yes.
Mayor Watson?
Yes.
24 yeas.
Thank you. Motion to adopt reports.
Mr. Mayor, before you move on, I have a motion moved by myself and seconded by Catherine Hobbs. Councillor Hobbs, be it resolved that the mayor's remarks given at the City Council meeting of the 27th of November 2013 be printed in the minutes of today's council meeting.
On the motion, carried. Thank you very much. Motion to adopt reports. Motion portant adoption de rapport. Councillor Blais, please. Seconded by Councillor Hubley.
That Community Protective Services Committee Report 28, Items A and B on the Bulk Consent Agenda, Planning Committee Report 68, Item C on the Bulk Consent Agenda, Planning Committee Report 61, Item 22 on the agenda, be received and adopted as amended.
Carried.
Carried.
Motions requiring suspension of the rules of procedure. Councillor Tierney has a motion with respect to FCM and Canada's housing crunch, seconded by Councillor Holmes, on suspension of the rules. Carried. Councillor Tierney, if you'd like to introduce it, please.
Great. Thank you very much, colleagues. Yesterday, the chair of CPS, Chair Taylor, proclaimed National Housing Day yesterday in Ottawa. Also, through the mayor's leadership, we've shown we're doing a lot for housing within this city. But unfortunately, it also involves other levels of government. So this week, FCM board members are meeting in Ottawa, and we're advocating, as we're getting close to the near end of an agreement we have with the federal government at this time. We've had a great relationship with them. So I'll dispense with the whereas clauses and go right to, therefore, be resolved that the City of Ottawa City Council endorse FCM's housing campaign and urge the Minister of Employment and Social Development to develop a long-term plan for housing that puts core investments on a solid ground, increasing predictability, protects Canadians from planned expiry of the $1.7 billion in social housing agreements, and ensure the healthy stock of affordable rental housing for Canadians. And be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be sent to the minister noted above, to the Ontario Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, and the Ottawa MPs, to the Federation of Canadian Municipalities, and the Association of Municipalities of Ontario.
Thank you. Councillor Wilkinson, on the motion.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just as Chair of the Ottawa Community Housing, I would like to, not only to support this motion fully, but I think we need to work on an action plan that we can do. The Toronto people were up here at Parliament Hill, and Councillor Holmes and I were there with them last week, but we need to be really pushing this. I know FCM is doing that with the members this week, but I'd hope that perhaps you yourself would take on the Mr. Mayor, that you would take on the job of continuing to put the efforts on that we need to have, because we are in not a very good shape for financing for our housing.
Great. Thank you. On the motion?
Carried.
Carried. Notices of motion for consideration at subsequent meetings. Councillor Fleury, do you have a seconder for your motion?
Councillor Moffat.
If you'd like to introduce this, this will be dealt with at the next meeting.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. This relates to a portion of Rideau Street east of King Edward that has no BIA, and a lot of groups have shown interest. So therefore be it resolved that the Economic Development and Innovative Department be directed to work with these three groups to review the BIA boundaries in this area to assess different options, including the formation of a third BIA and the expansion of an alternation of the boundaries of one or more of the existing BIAs. Furthermore, be it resolved that the Economic Development and Innovation Department present recommendations for the formation, expansion, or change in boundaries for the downtown Rideau BIA, Byward Market BIA, Rideau Street, and Sandy Hill in Q1 2015 following the end of the terms for the local boards.
Okay, thank you. Notice of motion, Councillor Thompson, please. Seconded by Councillor Hume, I believe.
Yes, it is. Thank you, Your Worship. And this is a requirement that we need to fulfill each year. And I hope at the next council meeting that I will have staff support for this motion. Therefore, be it resolved that City Council approve the following: that Councillor Deroche will be the city representative to the Ontario Good Roads Association, that Councillor Thompson be the city representative to the Rural Ontario Municipal Association, that Councillor Hume be the city's representative to the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, and that Councillor Chernyshenko be the city's representative to the Association Française de Municipalités de l'Ontario.
Okay, thank you. So that will be at our next council meeting. Are there any other notices of motion, Councillor Clark?
Well, I thought we should have a notice to motion to attach that last one, that we'll take nominations from the floor.
Would you like to serve on one of those boards, Councillor? No? Okay. Thank you. Any other notices of motion? Motion to introduce bylaws, motion portant présentation de règlement, Conseiller Blais, and Councillor Moffat has a declaration, so he'll remove himself from this vote, and Councillor Blais has the floor.
That the bylaws listed on the agenda under motion to introduce bylaws, three readings, be read and passed.
A confirmation bylaw, Councillor Blais.
Que le règlement suivant soit lu et adopté.
That the following bylaw be read and passed to confirm the proceedings of Council meeting of 27th November 2013. Adopté. Et j'aimerais...
Council, the Rink of Dreams official opening will take place tomorrow at noon. Please join myself and Cyril Leader and Spartacat to celebrate the beginning of the skating season. There'll be free hot chocolate, bring your skates. And just last season, we had 120 skating days and almost 60,000 users. The rink is open from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. with a heated hut. And we officially, really unofficially opened yesterday, which is the earliest it's opened in its 3 years of existence. So I hope you can join Cyril and Spartacat and myself. That's 12 noon tomorrow. Are there any written inquiries, Madam Deputy Clerk? Adjournment, Councillor Blais.
Mr. Mayor, I have an inquiry.
I'm sorry, Councillor, I don't think we had it, but go ahead.
I didn't, in fairness to our awesome Deputy Clerk. When renovating city recreation facilities, what steps are taken to bring the building up to standards with respect to accommodation?
Is that accommodation in terms of accessibility? Okay, so we'll have staff reply to that. Adjournment, Councillor Blais.
That the proceedings of the City Council meeting of 27 November 2013 be adjourned.
On adjournment, carried. Thank you all very much. Meeting adjourned. Merci beaucoup.